morning, TLF Church. Thank you for joining us online today. We pray that you're blessed and encouraged and challenged deeply as you listen to this message. Stay tuned for some worship.
Sing, it's fallen from the clouds.
It's fallen from the clouds. A strange and lovely sound. I hear it in the thunder and the rain. It's ringing in the skies like cadence in the night as the music of the universe plays. We're singing, you are holy, you're great and mighty. The moon and the stars declare who you are. And I'm so unworthy, but still sing of how great you are. Oh, how great you are.
Sing beautiful and free.
Beautiful and free. The song of galaxies reaching far beyond the Milky Way. And let's join with the sound. Come on, let's sing it out as the music of the universe plays. We're singing, you are holy, great and mighty. The moon and the stars declare who you are. And I'm so unworthy, but still you love me forever, my heart. We'll sing of you, and all glory, honor, and power is yours. Amen. And all glory, honor, and power is yours. Amen. And all glory, honor, and power is yours. Forever. Amen.
Sing our glory.
And all glory, honor, and power is yours. Amen. And all glory, honor, and power is yours. Amen. And all glory, honor, and power is yours. Forever. Amen. We're singing. Sing this with me. I stand before you, awed by your majesty. You're covered by your mercy, your blood has made me free. Draw me to you. Inside my
Sing, I give you my worship.
I give you my worship. And all of my passion. I give you my whole heart. All my devotion. Yeah. I pray this morning, I want to know you. Let your spirit overwhelm me. Let your presence overtake my heart. I want to know you. I want to know you. Let your spirit overwhelm me. Let your presence overtake my heart. I want to know you. I want to know you. Let your spirit overwhelm me. Let your presence overtake my heart. Sing, I give you my worship and all of my passion. I give you my whole heart. All my devotion. Sing, here I will bow, and here I will bow down. Say that I need you. Here I will worship. Say that I love you. Jesus, just want to know you more, God. One more time, I want to know you. Yes, I want to know you. Let your spirit overwhelm me.
Let your presence overtake my heart. And I want to know you. Let your spirit overwhelm me. Let your presence overtake my heart. Well, good morning, church, and thank you so much for joining us today. As you can tell, I'm not Pastor Fred. He's taking a little bit of a break, and today I am excited to share with you just the story of Jesus. Today marks Palm Sunday, and if you'll turn with me in your Bibles to Luke chapter 19. Again, we're going to be talking about Palm Sunday, and what is Palm Sunday? Palm Sunday is the day of triumph. It's a day of victory. It's a day of rejoicing. Why? Because this is the day that we remember that Jesus came into Jerusalem for the first time, the city of Jerusalem, for the first time throughout his ministry. And he does this so that he can fulfill what he came here ultimately to do. And that's to die on a cross for me, for you, for your mother, your father, your family, everyone on this earth. And the reason why this is important for us to talk about is because there's a certain amount of praise that happens when Jesus comes into Jerusalem, and we're gonna look at that here in just a moment. So again, if you'll turn with me to Luke chapter 19, we're gonna be starting in verse 28, and I'm reading from the New King James Version here. And it says this, it says, when he said this, he went ahead, going up to Jerusalem. And it came to pass when he drew near to Bethphage and Bethany at the mountain called Olivet, that he sent two of his disciples, saying, go into the village opposite you, where as you enter, you find a colt tied on which no one has ever sat. Loose it and bring it here. And if anyone asks you, why are you loosing it? Thus you shall say to him, because the Lord has need of it. So those who were sent went their way and found it just as it said to them. But as they were loosing the colt, the owners of it said to them, why are you loosing this colt? And they said, the Lord has need of him. Then they brought him the colt to Jesus, and they threw their clothes on the colt, and they set Jesus on him. And as he went, many spread their clothes on the road. Then as he was now drawing near the descent of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works they had seen, saying, blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory to God in the highest. Now we're going to pause there for just a moment. And let's pray real quick as we go into his word. Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for this opportunity to be in your word, to really understand what is happening in this moment as Jesus, you triumphantly come into Jerusalem in a humble, humble way. And Father, I just pray that we would allow our hearts to be open, our minds to be steady, and our mouths to be filled with praise this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. So again, as we're looking at this passage, as we're understanding where Jesus is coming from in this moment, just early on in this chapter, which obviously we know time works different than pages in a book, but early on in this chapter, we see that Jesus and his disciples were just in Jericho, where Zacchaeus was. And if you remember the song from when you were a little kid in Sunday school, you know, Zacchaeus was a wee little man was he. Climbed up in a sycamore tree to see what he could see, that whole thing. And we see this amazing transformation of Zacchaeus the tax collector, one of the most hated men in his region, to sitting next to Jesus, inviting him into his home and repaying all of his debts, being forgiven. And it's just an incredible transformation. And then we see Jesus later on, he begins to preach about talents and being given talents from God and gifts from God and stewarding them well. And then from that moment, we see Jesus turn and he comes to Jerusalem. Now, Jerusalem, as I mentioned, is a large city. This is where Jesus came so that he could be put on trial, so that he could be put to death, which we'll get to in a little bit. We're actually celebrating that later on this week with Good Friday and Easter and the Passover. But Jesus came to Jerusalem to celebrate the Passover, to celebrate the Jewish customs of the day. And he came so that because he knew that this was the place that he was destined to be, that God had called him to be in that moment. And as he's coming in, again, Jesus being the Messiah, Jesus being the Savior, as he's coming in, his disciples are kind of wondering what's happening. And so his disciples do as he says. As he says, they go and get the colt, and Jesus comes in on this little donkey and walks in triumphantly. Now, that word triumphantly is interesting. Why would Jesus be walking into a place he's never been to triumphantly? The reason is because of the people who were praising him. Now, let's look at this real quick. Again, let's go back to our text in Luke chapter 19. And it says this. It says then in verse 37, then as he was now drawing near the descent of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works they had seen, saying, blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Matthew's account in Matthew chapter 21 says, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, glory to God in the highest. Now, this word Hosanna is a Hebrew word, which is actually, and I'm probably going to butcher how to say this because I don't really speak Hebrew, but it's Hosanna, which means to save now. Why? Because these people had heard the mighty works of Jesus, and they knew the prophecies and the Torah and the writings about the coming Messiah. And they put two and two together and they recognized that Jesus, this man who was now coming in on a colt, was the Messiah. See, they learned that from the teachings again. Even in Zechariah 9, chapter 9, it says, rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. He is just and having salvation, lowly and riding on a donkey, a colt, a foal of a donkey. See, Jesus comes into Jerusalem having already taught for the last 3.5 years, having already prophesied and healed and done these miraculous works, and everybody in the land knew about him. He hadn't come to Jerusalem yet. And so as he walks into Jerusalem, he fulfills the prophecy that was told in Zechariah 9, chapter 9, or chapter 9, verse 9. And as Jesus does this, the people around him begin to recognize that this could truly be the Messiah. This could be the one who is coming to save us. And so they shout, Hosanna, save now. Hosanna in the highest, glory to God in the highest. They begin praising God and exalting him for Jesus coming into their city. And there's some important things that we need to pull out from their praise, that we need to understand about their praise. So let's look at our text again. Again, as they're praising, it says that as now he was drawing near the descent of the Mount of Olives, the entire multitude of disciples began praising. Now, what's important about that is that their praise was outside of the temple. See, it's custom, as we know, as we in the Church of America, to have worship services, to praise, to sing, have music, join together inside the church. I mean, that's what we've done for years. Obviously, not this last year. We had a little bit of a hiccup there with the pandemic and everything, and for our safety, and just out of, for our safety. we've decided to have services online, which we're glad that you're joining us today for that. And even this past couple weeks, having services online, we're not joined together, but we're still in a church setting. And these people who came to praise God were outside of the temple. They were outside of the church. They were in a place that was secular. They were in a secular setting. Now, for me and you, this could be the line in the coffee shop. This could be at the grocery store. This could be in your place of work. And it's important for us to recognize that when we see this Jesus, this Messiah, when we look toward his goodness and his mercies, that we praise him. Whether it's in a store, whether it's at home, whether it's at school, in our workplaces, we have to realize that we need to be the same and we need to speak the same, whether we are in the temple or out of the temple. Just as those who came to see Jesus and his entry into the city were. They praised God in the temple, and they recognized Jesus as God, and they praised him outside of the temple. Churches, it's up to us to recognize that moment. We have this opportunity uniquely in our country to be able to freely speak about our God, to be able to freely proclaim his goodness. We don't have to fear for our lives, which praise God for that. Because as we know, there's people around the world who don't have that same freedom or opportunity. And so for us, we need to take a moment each and every day and just praise God. Whether, again, if that's out loud in the coffee line, whether that's even not in the way that we speak, but in the way that we act. You know, maybe it's paying for the coffee behind you. Or God forbid the McDonald's, that God blesses and take away the calories from that. You know, it's paying for that behind you. It's spending time with somebody that normally nobody spends time with them. It's calling your parents or your kids and saying, hey, I'm thinking about you today. I'm praying for you. I love you. You know, it's up to us. We have to recognize that we have an opportunity to praise God outside the temple. We can shout Hosanna outside of the temple and say glory to God in the highest. We don't have to be here in this church. Now, I'm blessed to be here right now, looking at these four walls and just, you know, just taking in the things that happen here and really acknowledging that God is so great when we come together. But even if we can't, even if we're not, may we still proclaim Hosanna. May we still proclaim glory to God in the highest outside of the temple. Now, secondly, when we look at their praise, it says that they were all together. They were in unity. See, their praise, it says that the whole multitude began to sing praises. This wasn't just an individual aspect, and that's not how our lives should be. See, the followers of Jesus were lifting praises together. They believed that he was the Messiah, and there was something beautiful when they started praising together. Now, the Bible says that they began to lay down their garments in front of him as he walked in. They began to, other translations and other parts in Matthew say that they would cut down branches and palm leaves, which is where we get the term Palm Sunday, and they would lay them in front of him as he would walk towards the city, as this colt that he was riding would move towards the city. And they did that to show that they were for him, that they were there to worship him, they were there to grant him entry into the city and proclaim him as king. They didn't want his feet to get dirty as he walked through, and so they would lay down their garments. Church, may we as a people decide to lay down our garments in front of him. What does that look like? That looks like our time, our talents, and our treasures. May we say, God, this is what you've given me. Let me give it back to you. And it's not, again, an individual basis, but it's together in unison. Because when we work together, when we praise together, there is something so beautiful about that. One of my favorite phrases that I've always said growing up is that there is plurality in our unity. And unity in our plurality. What does that mean? That means that we are very different. We are vastly different people. I am a huge nerd. I love anything sci-fi, fantasy, Pokemon, like the works. A lot of you guys don't, and I'm okay with that. We listen to vastly different music. We like different foods. We go to different shows. We drive different cars. We work different places. We go to different schools. We have different ethnic backgrounds. We are all so different, but there is plurality in our unity, and unity or plurality. We have the opportunity to praise God together. We lift one voice. Paul writes that we are of one body, one mind, and one soul from one God for his purpose. May we not forget that, especially in times like now. There's been so many opportunities and missed opportunities, I should even say, for us as a church to reach out to those who are hurting, who are broken. Whether it's through Black Lives Matter, through that whole movement and being able to reach out and say, hey, I'm thinking about you, I'm praying about you, or even recently with the Asian American and island or Pacific Islander population in our country. There's so much hurt and pain. And yet, through that, may we be the church that speaks up. And in that, showing love, just as James says, that they will know us for our love for one another. In that, we can praise God. In that, we can proclaim his goodness. And the one thing that I love about this passage is you'll notice here, as we move a little bit down, Verse 37, then as he was drawing near, they began to praise. Verse 38, they said, blessed is the king who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory to God in the highest. And then it says this in verse 39. And some of the Pharisees called to him from the crowd, teacher, rebuke your disciples. What he was saying is, hey, you should probably tell them to calm down a little bit. They're creating a little bit of a ruckus out here. We don't want them to show up. Like, it's fine. They can praise you, but like maybe a little bit quieter. But the disciples, and remember the Pharisees, before I get to the disciples, the Pharisees were always people who were the religious people of the day. They knew the Torah. They knew the prophecies of the Messiah inside and out. They were the teachers. They were the religious leaders of the day. And they tell Jesus, hey, tell them to calm down. See, now the disciples praised, but the Pharisees just gazed on because they were like, I don't want to get involved in this. This is too much. This might not look good for me. But what if we were to flip that? What if instead of saying this might be too much, what if we say, you know what? I'm going to praise God anyway. I'm going to bless this group anyway. I'm going to praise God in the way that I talk to people, in the way that I walk, in the way that I live my life anyway. And I'm going to encourage my brothers and sisters in Christ to do the same. I'm going to talk to them, and we're going to formulate a plan and get together and serve this minority group, or serve this less fortunate group, or serve in the youth ministry, or serve in the food ministry. And we're going to bless God in the way that we treat people together. May that be our heart cry. May that be how we live our lives. May we not be so stoic that we wouldn't risk seeming brash for praising Jesus in all ways and in all that we do. Now, continuing on as we remember how they would praise Jesus, the praise that they had was joyful. The praise that these people, these disciples came in and they were praising God, it was a joyful noise. Which is a great movie starring Queen Latifah and Dolly Parton, circa 2006. I love that movie. Anyway, moving on. Their praise was joyful. Jesus entered the city to die. Jesus knew why he was there. Jesus knew that he was going to be there and he was going to celebrate Passover. He knew that one of his disciples was going to betray him, that he would be beaten and bruised and flogged. And yet these people were praising him with joy. Why is that? Well, number one, they didn't know all that. They're like, hey, the Messiah is here. Our king is here. This is great. Like, we get to praise Jesus freely. He's like right here. We've heard about all these great things. And they were excited to see him. But also, they understood what it meant to praise. See, the word praise is a Hebrew word of todah. And if you've studied worship, you've studied any sort of praise, there's about 8 different words for worship or for praise in the Hebrew language. And this one specifically is todah. And that word means to shout and express gratitude to God for his promised deliverance. His promised deliverance. Now, the great thing about this is that we see these people are, they're not just, bless you, God. That was great. We're so glad you're here. No, they were excited. They were ecstatic that Jesus was here because they had grown up hearing the stories of the Messiah. They had grown up hearing that God was going to come and save them from sin and deliver them out of iniquity. And here was Jesus to do that very thing. And so they decided to praise, to express gratitude, to shout gratitude for the promised deliverance that God had for them. Because here he was. He came in riding on a colt, humbly before them. They had heard the stories about him and they were ready. They were expectant for what he would do. Now, their expectations may have been a little bit different. As I'd mentioned, they probably thought that he was going to come in swinging, take out the king at the time, take out the Pharisees, and do all that fun stuff that we think of Arthurian, sort of like King Arthur and his knights come in and just slay the beast sort of thing. When in reality, Jesus, as we know, came to die. but then to resurrect again. But see, they didn't know that. They just knew that their king was here, that their Messiah was here. Church, our praise, when we praise God freely, it should be with joy. It should be with expectation. And it should be at all times. I love reading the book of Job. I love reading the book of Psalms and just Paul and these different people in the Bible who go through the roughest of times. And yet they praise. David, one of my favorite examples, would be running from Saul, running for his absolute life of the guy that he is supposed to be looking up to and learning from. He would be running from him, and yet he would take a moment to pen down words that say, God, I praise you. David later would be running from his own son trying to kill him, to murder him. And he would take the moment to say, God, I praise you because you are a good God. Job, having lost everything, literally everything, a wealthy man loses his family, his livelihood, his house, his livestock, all of his servants. He lost everything material to him, and he said, God, I will still praise you. This needs to be us, that we praise joyfully when God brings us to something, when something happens in our life, because praise and joy doesn't come from a moment. It doesn't come from a circumstance. Joy is a fruit of the Spirit that we allow to birth inside of us and grow inside of us so that we can constantly feed from that. There's a whole nother study that we can do just on joy and the fruits of the Spirit in that. But just take this. May we allow joy to grow inside of us so that it becomes a part of us. And from that joy, may we praise God endlessly and abundantly. And finally, their praise was a necessity. This is one of my favorite verses in the book of Luke, because Jesus says this phrase that is so small, yet so important. Verse 39, chapter 19 of Luke, verse 39. And some of the Pharisees called to him from the crowd, saying, Teacher, rebuke your disciples. But Jesus answered and said to them, I tell you that if these should keep silent, the stones would immediately cry out. First of all, that's a kind of a terrifying thought, that if we were to stop praising, that all of a sudden, like, rocks would just start singing. That'd be, do you think they would sing rock music? I don't know. Anyway, Rolling Stones maybe. But Jesus is having a moment with these disciples, and he says, if these people stop praising, if my disciples stop praising, the rocks will cry out. Why? Because in us, it's so innate. It's something that is so intrinsic to who we are. It's part of our DNA to praise God or to praise something. I mean, if you look, we have people that go to sporting events, we go to concerts, we go to movies, we go to restaurants, whatever it is, and we can yell and scream and sing and shout and all this stuff and just be so excited and ecstatic for the moment that's happening. Why? Because there's something inside of us that longs to praise, that longs to worship. And that's in all of nature. The Bible writes in the Old Testament that the heavens declare the glory of God. And Jesus even here says, as we mentioned, that the rocks would cry out if we don't. And I pray that that would never be what happens. That we would be a people that decides that we will cry out. See, praise is the only response to Jesus. Praise can be the only response to his mercy and his salvation and his goodness. Because when we truly understand what his mercy means, when we truly understand his salvation and him coming to us and saying, I will give all of me so that I can have all of you, it's incredible to think of. Praise must be our only response. It's not a simple, oh, thanks, that was great, and I'll see you next week on Sunday. That's not how Jesus rolls. That's not how we should roll. As Christians, as people who follow Christ, who have really accepted his salvation and his mercy, may we be so much more than just a Sunday morning Christian. May we be so much more than just somebody who comes on a Wednesday night and watches our study through the book of Luke, or somebody that comes in on Christmas and Easter and says, "Woohoo, that was great. I got my fill for the year." May we praise God in everything that we do because we follow him, because we read his word, because we have communion with him. We are not just a Sunday morning Christian, but we allow our lives to be devoted to him and that we praise him because of his mercy and his goodness. Now, it's interesting about Luke chapter 19 and just the rest of that chapter, and even as we see in the other gospels, as we all know the story, Jesus goes to die on a cross, but before that, he's put to trial. He goes to the Passover dinner, the Last Supper, and Judas betrays him. Judas, being one of the disciples, betrays him and says, "This is the man who claims to be the Messiah. Arrest him, take him." And Jesus is put on trial. Pontius Pilate comes up and he there's a moment where he says, I have an option here. I can either release Barabbas, who is a thief, a robber, a murderer, you know, what have you, or I can release Jesus, who really hasn't done much. No, he's done a few miracles. And Pontius Pilate is giving the people of Jerusalem an opportunity to choose. Would you rather have Barabbas? And I encourage you to read the entire story here, but would you rather have Barabbas, who is guilty, or Jesus? And they cry out, "Give us Barabbas." And so he says, "What would you have me do with this Jesus, with this King of the Jews?" And we hear resoundingly the crowd begin to cry out, "Crucify him. Crucify him." Now, the crucifixion is the most terrible of deaths. That was truly meant for sinners, truly meant for the worst of the worst, to be hung and broken on a cross to where you suffocate. You're not killed instantly, but you suffocate from the pressure of your body just collapsing under its own weight. And they yell, "Crucify him." And church, I can't help but wonder if many of those in the crowds were the same that were there before, welcoming into the city. What if there was a few? What if there was somebody who was there at the beginning and is like, "Oh, everybody else is laying down their jackets. Let me put mine down real quick. And hey, Jesus, good to see you." And then later on that week, they're like, "Maybe I was wrong." And they begin to yell, "Crucify him." I feel like that's a lot of us sometimes. Again, we come to church and on Sundays and we do our due diligence. We sing worship and praise and maybe we even pay tithes. Maybe we have a devotional life, or we only listen to worship music. And yet in our spirit, in our quiet place, in the place we don't want anybody else to see, our sin is yelling, "Crucify him." Our lifestyle is yelling, "Crucify him." And we only allow Jesus to be a part of our lives instead of Jesus to take over our lives. See, for the longest time in my life, if I'm completely honest, church was a huge part of my life, but Jesus wasn't. I was so accustomed to showing up on a Sunday and acting the act, talking the talk, walking the walk on the Sunday morning, and then as soon as I got home, it was all gone. I had no communication with Jesus, no life with him outside of church. And then there came a point where I recognized that I needed Jesus more than I could ever imagine. His salvation, his mercy was something that I needed so desperately. And I asked God for forgiveness, and he allowed me to walk through that. And yes, there are still days where I struggle. Yes, there are still days where I'm not, you know, 100% reading my Bible 24 hours a day. You know, I have a job, I have other things that I need to do, but it's a lifestyle that I've decided to go into, a relationship with Jesus, where I communicate, where I have communion with him, where I read the word, where I pray, where I worship God, where I praise him. I can't allow my praises to be short-lived. My praises can't be short-lived. I love this quote here. "Do not let your praises be short-lived. Do not allow the same voice that cries Hosanna to be the very voice that shouts, "Crucify him." Church, as we celebrate this Palm Sunday again, this is a joyous day. This is a day of triumph and of victory. May we determine within ourselves that today is not just Palm Sunday, that we're not allowing it to just be right now, to just be during this online service. But may we determine in ourselves to celebrate Christ and praise him every single day, day in and day out, on our good days and on our bad days, on our days where we feel like we're on top of the world and when we're underneath the boat and drowning under all the pressures of life. May we still say, "Yet I will praise you." And church, if you'll pray with me, Father, I thank you for your word. God, I thank you that you came into Jerusalem on that day, and then we get to celebrate this Palm Sunday. We get to celebrate and praise you for your triumphant entry into our lives. But Father, may we continue to praise you no matter what. May we continue to cry, "Hosanna." May we continue to have a life that is toward you and for you, God, and not for our own devices. God, may we continue to love you and to worship you in all that we do. God, on the highest mountaintops, may we praise you. In the valleys low, may we praise you. God, in the good times and bad times, when it's dark and night and we don't know where we're going, God, may we praise you. When we're hurting, when we feel broken, may we praise you. When we are elated and happy and joyful, may we praise you. When we're just kind of blah and nothing's happening and we just feel kind of flat and everything is monotonous and we may even feel emotionally numb, God, may we praise you. May our response to your mercy and goodness and salvation be worship, be praise, to exclaim and shout about your proclaimed goodness and your promised deliverance, God. May that be our life. May that be who we are and a character of our DNA, Father. God, we praise you, we love you, and we give you all the glory and all the honor and all the fame. In Jesus' name, amen.
If ever I deny your grace,
eyes remind me of the price you paid. Hallelujah, a living remembrance.
Come on, let's just declare this morning just the greatness, the goodness of our God. That's just part of who He is. He's a good God. He's a good Father. Let's just declare that this morning.
'Cause you've been so, so good to me. You've been so, so good to me. Oh, to think where I would be if not for you, if not. From the depths, as far as east is from the west, so far your grace has carried me. Until I see your face to face, until at last I've won my race, remind me you're not finished yet. Again, God, we will remember you and your sacrifice. 'Cause you've been so, so good to me, and you've been so, so good to me. And just to think where I would be. Not for you, not for you.
Thank you for listening to that message. We know how difficult it may be to process some of the heavy topics and issues we're talking about here in this series. The Holy Spirit has spoken specific things to your heart. It's possible that you have questions that you would like further discussion on. If so, we really encourage you to reach out to one of our pastors or leaders who are available and would love to have an open dialogue with you. Just simply go to our website at www.tlfchurch.com/connect, or you can send us a text at 323-389-7006. Remember, you can give online through our website, or you can send in your tithes and offerings by mail. You can find all the info on how to do that by going to www.tlfchurch.com/online-giving. Thank you so much for your continual support during this time. We want to let you know that we have our Kids Church Online that meets on a weekly basis through our secured Google Classroom. If you're interested in our Kids Church Online platform, please visit our TLF Online page. Click on the Kids Church Sign Up button to connect with one of our leaders. On Sunday nights, our prayer team is committing 1 hour of prayer from 5 p.m. to 6 p.m. If you have any prayer requests or praise report, you can leave us a message on our TLF online page, or you can send us an email at prayer@tlfchurch.com, or send us a text at 323-389-7006. On Wednesday nights, we have our midweek unplugged Bible study at 7 p.m., in which a new devotional will be posted on our website. Join us for this amazing study on the book of Luke. We thank you for joining us online today. We hope that you are blessed, encouraged, and challenged through that message. Hit like, subscribe, feel free to share this video with others. We love you. We thank you for joining us. We hope to see you again next time. God bless.